Today's theme for this TEDx is undercurrent and looking for the subtleties underneath that make all of the difference. Today we're going to be looking at together the undercurrent of maths and it being a language. And what I'd invite you to see is that this is going to be the piece that makes all the difference. All the difference for the student that thinks that they're dumb because of the way that we've taught it to them. All the difference for the teacher that feels anxious in teaching maths to that student. All the difference for the prison inmate that's 32 and can't tell the time. All the difference for the baby that's just about to be overdosed because the nurse doesn't understand maths. And possibly all of the difference for you. When you see this word maths, what does it engender for you? Does it make you feel anxious? Do you feel comfortable knowing your finances? Do you know how to navigate maths in your everyday life? Or does it actually engender for you some anxiety? Today, I'm going to actually show you this part, as I said, that maths is a language. And when you look at the definition of a language, you can read this, but it says it's a system of spoken and written symbols that we use to communicate. I'm going to show you some slides of different languages, and every symbol that you see actually tells you an animal. But what I want you to notice as I go through these slides, and I'll just go through them quite quickly, is that you probably don't know what these symbols mean. This is Japanese. This is Arabic. If you saw this, if I saw this in Arabia, I would have no clue what it meant. This is Hindi. If I was in India traveling, and if those of you that have traveled to India, you might see this and think, I've got no idea what that's talking about. This is Chinese, French, for exactly the same animal, Spanish for the same animal, and only these symbols you'll recognize. But what was the piece that made it that when you saw these symbols, you knew what it meant? This beautiful animal that's been possibly your best friend and that you've had some relationship with. So that's what we're going to look at today, the simple way that we took that part, those symbols, and actually made them, that you created an image in your mind when you saw those words stuck together. So you see that, yes, they're just squiggles, they have absolutely no meaning, but in the language of English, they, when we put them together, make us think of the dog that we know and love. So let's look at how did we learn this language? How did we make this connection between the dog and D-O-G? What I'm going to propose to you today is an approach that you may have heard about, but we saw the dog, we touched it. It was three-dimensional, yes? We had a relationship with it. It was something tangible to us. We then saw pictures and we saw videos and picture books, the countless number that we saw, and somebody pointed to and said, oh, that's a dog. And then eventually we said, if we put these symbols together, then you're going to think of the dog. It's what's considered the concrete to representational to abstract picture or a way of teaching. And I'm going to share with you some subtleties of this approach that are the pieces that make all of the difference. When you think of a language, and as we walk through this, consider as you think back to those symbols that I showed you on the slides, that each language has its own symbols, its own little alphabet, it has its own rules and its own vocabulary. So maths is a language. It has its own symbols. And our symbols of maths, similarly, you could look at it as the alphabet of maths, are our 0, our 1, our 2, our 3, etc. Yes? Like the alphabet, they're random squiggles and random words that we've chosen to mean this is one of something. You'll see some blocks on your tables that show this. This is one. Now if I add one more to it, this is two. I add one more to it, it's three. But if you think of those squiggles, these squiggles, they have no meaning inherent within them, do they? You would never be able to look at a three and think, oh, that means three of something. It's this shape. It's just a shape that's random. Even these symbols, it's like, what did we say? Who said that this two lines together was going to mean I'm going to add something? Or this multiplication sign, I'm going to multiply. random squiggles that actually have no inherent meaning. But if we start with the other piece of maths where we have its own rules, and you think of every language that you've ever learnt, it has its own rules. The language of English, we have rules, yes? We speak left to right. We say, we have particular rules as how we engage with our language, particular ways we write sentences. There are rules and exceptions to the rules. And if you're a teacher trying to teach English, you know that there are many exceptions to the rules in the language of English. So maths, we have our own rules as well. We start at zero when we're counting. We count to nine. Nine is our largest number. If you think of units, tens and hundreds, this repeating pattern, we can only have zero units, one unit, two unit. Once we get to 10, we can't stay in the units place. So that's a rule that we have in maths. 10 is equal to 1 in our base 10 system. It's another rule that we have. If I have 10 ones, I've got 1 10. If I've got 10 tens, I've got 100. I've got 10 hundreds, I've got 1,000. So it's just another rule within maths. This repeating hundreds, tens unit pattern. And left to right with exceptions. And if you think of the exceptions, if you think of students that you've taught that when they're writing the number 91, we see left to right, I'm saying the value, then the place. 90, one unit, and I drop the unit. When I say 19, I've just messed that up, yes? I've just all of a sudden said 19. I've said the smallest number from the right to the left. I've said it's a teen. And even something as simple as that, where if we don't teach the accuracy of that language or the exceptions, then our students have difficulty understanding. So the other piece that maths has its own vocabulary, all these strange words that we use to describe something that's very understandable if we relate it to our everyday life. So how should we teach this language that I'm saying is called maths? And I was just reminded this morning of Galileo, apparently in 1604, the father of science said, the book of the universe is written in the language of maths. So let's look at this, how we would teach maths. And I'm going to suggest that same way that we taught you to understand that D-O-G means the dog that you saw and created the picture of, we can do exactly the same when we have a tool to teach maths. This is a little green block, yes? This green block, we're going to keep the colour consistent, just the same as when we look at money. Our entire money system is based on colour. We know that colour helps us to remember. Colour helps us to categorise pieces. But when we wanted to actually, like our world became bigger, we wanted to do more than count. So we attribute a colour and a block to a particular number. Imagine if we thought of two, the squiggle on the piece of paper, that we could see is a two blocks. It's orange, it's always going to stay orange, and I can see that it's two units joined together. Three, the squiggle, is pink. It's three units joined together. And all of these other numbers that we can show that have a particular image that we can see that we start with before we get to the squiggle. So that the squiggle actually has meaning behind it. When I am going to then progress a student, I want them to be able to add. And if you think of the addition symbol, it's two lines that are brought together. We want, every time we're adding, to bring just two numbers together. I don't want to see 1, 2 plus 1, 2, 3 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm not adding there, I'm counting still. So this progression that happens when a student's actually able to add to bring two numbers together. But for them to see that, we have to walk them through a process where they can touch, feel and see, the three-dimensional, when they can draw pictures that are accurate proportionately, and then when we can create meaning and understanding or connect a symbol to what I've touched, felt and seen and drawn the pictures of. So I'm going to walk you through an example here. And if you saw this on a piece of paper, you would have to know what 2 was, what 3 was, and the simplicity I'm going to show you when we actually use these blocks. So imagine a 2, when you saw that squiggle, you thought of a 2 orange block. And imagine when you saw the plus sign, you knew you're bringing another number next to it. And the 3 was pink, and it's 3 units joined together. And you can see your equal sign, it's telling you that whatever you have on this side has to be the same as what you have on this side. Imagine if you could show all of that with some blocks. And you could create the opportunity that when I see those squiggles, like when I saw the dog, I actually saw a 2, a 3, they're smooshed together. I just need to find the block that's the same length as or equal to that 2 plus 3. You know, we all learn through images. It's just part of the way that we learn any language. And let's actually look at another one. So even as you see here, like if you have a 2 and a 3, and you have the 5 underneath it, you've just created your equal symbol. So every single piece of maths in the abstract, the squiggles, can actually be taken out of the code and brought into a picture that I can rely on and recreate with so much ease. So whether we write it like this or like this makes no difference. Every part is just a squiggle. And I've just shown you a picture here. It's exactly what we're doing. We want to build the picture, draw the picture, and write it in the abstract, just the same way we taught the language of English or Japanese or Chinese, where those symbols meant absolutely nothing until we actually had the concrete first. So let's look at multiplication, because this is one of the pieces. You know, we have so many parts where we think, oh, we have to teach rote memorization. I'm sure many of you would have had experiences of learning multiplication tables and having it drilled in, yes? But what I hope you understand is that when we just try to drill those facts in, it's like putting those Japanese symbols or the Chinese symbols in front of you and I and expecting us to remember them. There's no wonder our kids struggle with maths and have anxiety about maths. So let's actually see, let's build a rectangle and tell me how many square units there are in that rectangle. So let's say we had this one. 5 times 3 is equal to what? And instead of you having to try to remember your multiplication facts, imagine if you were able to just build a rectangle that had 5 across, counted 3 times, I can see it, I'm always going to be accurate, it's always going to be true, I know my answer. I'm not having to remember and try to cram into my memory particular components of mathematics that has no connection to anything else in my world. Imagine if I could see this, and every time I'm doing a multiplication, I'm building a rectangle and seeing how many square units do I have inside that. Whether I write my answer like this or like this, every single squiggle that you see here can be decoded and seen from a picture that I've created. And if you can see, like even when I show you a picture of a dog, you remember the picture of the dog. We learn through pictures. The best book that you read last was the book that enabled you to recreate a picture. You don't remember the symbols on the piece of paper, the squiggles that you read. So this way that I was talking about, the subtlety, the undercurrent, the part where we want to build and have a consistent colour. You know, when you think of our money system, when we've had it in physical form, has been pretty much dependent just on colour. So we know colour helps us to remember. So when we take this part of saying, we can be accurate and show this squiggle too, it's orange, I can see the demarcation, that part is really key as well. I need to be able to see the 2 is 2 units joined together. I want the student to draw. They're going to draw a picture themselves of what they've built. I was thinking about this and thinking, you know, even a dog. If I drew a dog that had different proportions, I could actually make the dog look like a dinosaur. But it's the proportional accuracy that enables us to actually make the connection and understand what we're working with. Then the writing and saying, but basically the last piece, the writing, the saying, the abstract, is the last point we should get to. The squiggles on the piece of paper that now can have meaning. So what I would like to leave you with is that next time that you think of teaching maths to a child, or next time you wonder why they or even you might struggle with maths, I hope you'll remember it's just a language. And they should struggle with the way that we've taught it to date. You should have struggled with maths, if you have, with the way you've been taught straight to the squiggles and memorise squiggles as if I put Japanese or Chinese or any other language squiggles in front of you. They should have and you should have. But I hope that you'll see that if you use our blocks or something that's like shows those demarcations and keeps a consistency of colour, and you approach it that you're going to actually teach this accuracy, that you'll see that maths is the language that it is. Actually, the simplest language in the entire world for us to learn. Thank you.